I declare the congregation open. My Lords, Lords Lieutenant, Madam Mayor, Members of Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, it's an enormous pleasure and privilege for me as Pro-Chancellor to welcome you today to this ceremony. The installation of a new Chancellor is a special event at every university. But at Lancaster, it's not only special, it's been an extremely rare one. And in this year marking our adventure into our second half century, we are witnessing the installation of only our third Chancellor of this university. One or two of you present may have been at the start of Princess Alexandra's long and distinguished reign. I'm sure I see Lord Taylor of Blackburn in the audience, and I'm sure he was then chairman of Blackburn Education Committee and present at that great event. Many more of you will have been present for Chris Bonington's installation 10 years ago. And at this point, I'd just like to say, you know, we've said this on many university occasions before, but it's worth doing again. A very big thank you to Chris from the bottom of all our hearts for the grace, charm, and commitment with which he's carried through his decade of office as Chancellor. Chris, thank you very, very much. so Alan, you've got a very hard act to follow, but I'm confident you'll fulfill it with distinction. And of course, you'll be able to rely on Chris's help because he has taken on wonderfully this role as Chancellor's Ambassador. Now, Lancaster University, I'd just like to say a word about it, the institution of which Alan Milburn is our new Chancellor. For me, Lancaster is a blazingly successful emblem of Britain's transformation in the last half century. It was born of a mix of local initiative and national vision. A national vision that was shared between the main political leaders of the day, that Britain had to modernize its economy, its society, its view of its role in the world, and creating a new range of universities was an essential part of this. This was first initiated by Harold Macmillan when he was Prime Minister, and it was, I suppose, the remembered best in Harold Wilson's famous speech, in which he talked about a new society forged in the white hot heat of the scientific revolution back in 1973. Now, it's always very easy to mock and belittle these visions, but certainly the transformation of our country to a knowledge economy, there certainly has been. Think of how it's affected Lancaster locally. I remember a conversation with Stanley Hennig, one of our distinguished former deputy pro-chancellors of this institution, who was elected Member of Parliament for Lancaster in 1966. And Stanley told me that then they were getting on for 10,000 manufacturing jobs in Lancaster. Well, now, today, it is the university and the activities linked to the university, the growth that it generates, as well as its role as a major employer, which is one of the major economic contributors, if not the major economic contributor, to the town and the area. And literally, one of the most things that amazed me when I became pro-chancellor, literally the whole world walks across Lancaster's campus. And it's an extraordinary success when you think of it, of this northwest city in the north, you know, well away, as it were, from the highlights of metropolitan life, that we have been able to internationalize in this way. And I think the great thing about Lancaster is that it has combined excellence, really high excellence, with creating wider opportunity. And I think if you think about it, it's the living repudiation of those who used to argue in education 50 years ago that more means worse. It's a repudiation of that view. Think of the excellent results we had from the recent research assessment. We are leading in research in many key areas. We have a higher proportion of our staff engaged in high quality research than any universities outside Oxbridge and the leading London institutions. We've invested in the last few years in chemistry, engineering. Our new Chancellor's opening the new engineering lab this afternoon, the library. We've had increasing international success and increasing international recognition. But with those successes, we've also managed to combine at Lancaster a very good experience for our students, We always come out well around in the top 10 in the league tables, and applications are up, and applications are up without any lowering of academic quality. And we are also for a top research and teaching institution. We can proudly boast, and the only institution that in any way matches this is Queen Mary in London, that we can proudly boast that we recruit a higher proportion of our students from state schools and deprived backgrounds than most comparable institutions. So Lancaster is an example of the success of modern Britain, of a successful Britain, of a Britain that's open to the world as it should be. And that's why I think in Alan Milburn we have made the right choice as our new Chancellor, because very few people in their own person better exemplify Lancaster's success. Alan was brought up in the old mining village of Towlaw in County Durham. He went to Stokesley Comprehensive in Newcastle, and he won a place at Lancaster the first time anyone from his family had been to university. And from that springboard of Lancaster, he went on to be MP for Darlington, Secretary of State for Health, and he now roams the globe in a combination of distinguished capacities. But he's also appointed by the coalition government as the chair of the Social Mobility Commission. He hasn't forgotten his origins or what this university is about. It's the wider opportunity that Lancaster has created and will continue to create. So it is with great pleasure that I call on the Vice Chancellor to present our Chancellor.
I have pleasure in confirming that at a meeting held in the Lent term of 2014, the court of the university elected as Chancellor, in succession to Sir Christian Bonington, the Right Honourable Alan Milburn, alumnus and Honorary Doctor of Laws. Chancellor, it is my great privilege as Vice Chancellor to welcome you to our Great Hall for this, your installation, and in a moment ask you to make the declaration and to assume the robes of office. Chancellor, I now invite you to make that declaration.
I, Alan Milburn, hereby declare that I will well and truly serve the University of Lancaster in the office of Chancellor, in accordance with the charter and statutes of the university and its values, and that I will faithfully endeavour to uphold the rights and privileges of the university.
Chancellor, I now invite you to assume your robes of office.
Chancellor, on behalf of the Senate, I here present unto you Susan Maria Andy for conferral of the degree of Doctor of Letters, honoris causa. SuAndi is a poet and performance artist of international stature, but she's also so much more than this. A jazz dance teacher, writer, librettist, creative arts administrator and teacher, the protean nature of her work as a professional artist is in many ways reflective of the content of that work itself. For she has consistently declined to be defined by the constraining categorizations of others. Deeply rooted in particularities, she refuses to be contained by them. A passionate northerner, her work has been acclaimed not only beyond the north of England, but far outside the borders and shores of England itself. A consciously black writer, her work powerfully speaks to readers of all races. She has sought to provoke and challenge, not for its own sake, but with a view to inducing her hearers to see the world differently. To this end, she has sought to refigure the frames of reference through which the world appears to them. She has been widely acclaimed for her success in precisely these endeavors across many fields of creativity. SuAndi was born in 1951 in Hume, Manchester. Her mother was a Liverpudlian of Irish ancestry, and her father a Nigerian sailor. This parentage was to loom large in much of her later writing, through which we learn that although they were soon divorced, they were nonetheless united in their joint calling as her parents. And although there was subsequently little affection between them, they were as one in the depth of their love for their daughter. After leaving school, her early work was as multifaceted as her later work as a professional artist. She qualified as a teacher of ballet and tap dancing, was a dancer herself and a model, as well as a children's social worker. The transition to being a professional writer and performer was in some ways accidental. She had written a work of family history, which was initially intended to circulate only within her family. But when she shared it with friends, they encouraged her to publish it. And it was this that set her on the path that would culminate in her becoming a professional writer and performer. From the outset, she practiced poetry. But from the mid-1980s onwards, she quickly established a reputation not only as a poet, but more specifically as a performance poet and latterly a practitioner of live art. It has been said that live art occurs when an artist chooses to make work directly in front of the audience in space and time. So instead of making an object, a poem, for example, and leaving it for the audience to encounter in their own time, live art comes into being at the actual moment of encounter between artist and spectator. SuAndi has established herself as a master of the art, and she's performed her poems throughout Britain, Europe, North America, and beyond. Of all her works, perhaps her most acclaimed has been her The Story of M. The poem is a polemical one that is simultaneously biographical and autobiographical. The M of the title is predominantly her mother, Margaret, who is dying of cancer, and through a dramatic monologue, reflects on her relationship with her daughter and on the vicissitudes of her life, which have been set against a context of cultural prejudice and social deprivation. Towards the end of the poem, as our colleague Robert Crawshaw explains, her voice mutates into that of her daughter, SuAndi, who presents herself as the proud black child of a mixed-race background, someone who openly challenges the assumptions and presumptions of her implied audience and the culturally hegemonic society which it represents. Very different, both in genre and in content, is another of her acclaimed works, her first opera libretto, Mary Seacole. This dramatizes the life of the remarkable 19th century Jamaican nurse who crossed the world to England to offer her services to Florence Nightingale, by whom she was ultimately rejected. Undaunted, she set about financing herself and went on to practice nursing in the Crimean War. She published her own autobiography in 1857, and SuAndi takes this narrative and casts it into a radically different genre so as to address a diversity of questions around community and belonging. SuAndi herself sees these two heterogeneous works as being intimately linked. In an interview, she said that one motivation of her work has been to question the assumption that black and mixed-race people are confused about their identities. She said, "It's not that we are confused about our identities at all, but we are people whose stories have been suppressed so much that the identity issue seems important." This is a theme that surfaces explicitly at the end of The Story of M, and also lies at the heart of Mary Seacole. But these outstanding works constitute only the tip of a large iceberg. She has published numerous volumes of poetry, and her poetry performances have been extensively recorded and broadcasted. Since its foundation in 1985, she has given much time and energy to her work as a voluntary cultural director of the Black Arts Alliance, a national organization that was formed to give greater visibility to black artists. She has also devoted herself to cultivating the arts at a local level, leading writing workshops in countless venues across the country, including here at our university. She has thus been very tangibly not only a practitioner, but also a servant of her art. In addition to creating her own works, she has done much to encourage others to bring their talents to fruition, both within the black and mixed-race communities and beyond them. It is in recognition of her extensive work in all these diverse areas that she was appointed an officer of the Order of the British Empire in 1999. SuAndi is a poet, writer, and artist of distinction. The university is proud of the association it has had with her over the years and is delighted to deepen that association by the conferral of an honorary degree. Chancellor, on this auspicious day of your installation, it is therefore an especial privilege to present to you, on behalf of the Senate, SuAndi, for conferral of the degree of Doctor of Letters, honoris causa.
Chancellor, I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Letters, honoris causa.
Chancellor, Vice-Chancellor, fellow members of the university, and honoured guests. Well, Lancaster had managed to do what Hollywood couldn't do, hit diversity. You might be confused why the award has been given my name as Susan Maria Andy, where I actually work under the name of SuAndi. It's kind of my Madonna name. So what makes this perfect is that Lancaster didn't fall into the error that lots of places have done by introducing me as SuAndi, O.B.E. The assumption that the O.B.E. is actually my surname, you know, with me being African. When I first received it, my friend Scotty, who only lives down the road in the lake, sent me a card that said, "Outstanding Black Example." I thought, that's brilliant. My friend Pavinda, who's Ugandan Asian, sent me a card that said, other, I'm going to spell this word. It said, other, B-U-G-G-E-R-S, buggers, efforts. And I thought, actually, she's right. Because nobody achieves anything on their own. The success of my career has benefited from the trust of promoters in community centres and venues, from the Bridgewater Hall to my opera in Covent Garden. The highlights have been every workshop, in a school or a prison, every panel I've spoken on, and every university lecture I've given, like here in Lancaster. The first time I performed on this campus, I was astonished to see it's got a petrol station. And I thought, it's like a city. Which in reality it is, but it's a global city, where education and learning is a shared experience between staff and students, drawn from local and national and international arena. No matter where the topic is, English, science, research, theatre, and far too many others to mention, tutelage is not just from the top down, but it's a bit like painting. It goes crosswise and crossways. In an environment that is not separated by class, race, gender, sexual preference, or those who refuse to be impeded or indeed restricted by their differing physical limitations. Here, teams are flexible, changing collectives, working together to achieve a united goal. And much in the same way, I, along the years, have worked with some amazing artists across the membership of National Black Arts Alliance. We need this support in case we trip, and I've tripped numerous times. But failure only happens when there are not others there to support you. As a child, I used to think that my Nigerian father was illiterate, when in truth he was bilingual, as indeed was my mum, because she spoke Liverpool Scouse and standard English. But they only received basic schooling. By their collected effort, they raised me to understand that wherever I went, I reflected and represented all black people in my character and my behavior. I don't know how they think I'm doing today, but I wish Kanye West's parents had told him to do the same. And if you don't know who Kanye West is, then I'm sorry, you're just old. Now, whether I'm working, be it in Manchester, in any city across the UK, in any country, Europe, Africa, India, or across the Americas, I vow to take every opportunity to represent this university, to be an ambassador to the best of my ability. And one last thing. UNICEF has named 2015 the Year of Hope. Let us all hope and pray that every graduating student, regardless of their cultural identity and heritage, be like a leaf joined to a branch of learning, linked to a tall, strong tree with roots embedded in a world that in time will offer not just hope, but the reality of peace for all humanity, so that war and terror will become a distant memory. And as they sang 50 years ago in Selma, Alabama, together we will overcome.